just speak mysteries. Let's just speak mysteries unto God. Let's appreciate Him. Let's thank Him. Let's honor Him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We give you all the glory, honor, and adoration. You are worthy. You deserve it. We give you every praise that you deserve today. Thank you, Lord. 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 We give you praise. We worship you. We honor you. We adore you. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. We give you praise. We magnify you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We give you praise. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying.
Amen.
I want us to pray this prayer, and I want you to pray with understanding. One of the prayers that Jesus said we should pray is that His kingdom will come and His will be done. I want us to just pray that, Lord, in my life, let Your will be done. Let Your will be done in my life. Let Your will be done in my life. You see, when the will of God is done in your life, everything aligns with the purpose. Now, sometimes things doesn't look like it. But when the will of God is done, everything that even the enemy thought is working against you, God will turn it around and make it good. So I want us to just declare it and say, Lord, let Your will be done in my life, in my family, in my career. Anything that is not God's will, anything that is not God's purpose, anything that does not showcase what God's plan, Lord, I declare that let Your will be done in my life. Let Your will be done in my home. Let Your will be done in my family. Let Your will be done in our ministry. Let Your will be done in every area of my life. In my career, let Your will be done. In the name of Jesus, I give You praise. I worship You. I bless You. I honor You. Thank You, dear Father. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying. Father, according as we have prayed, I declare in every area of our life that, Lord, Your kingdom will be established there. Your will be done in the name of Jesus. I decree that, Lord, from this moment, there will be a turning around in the name of Jesus. Let everything work together for our good and to the glory of Your name in the name of Jesus. You have called us according to Your purpose. So we declare that only Your will be done in our life. In the name of Jesus, I speak unto every sickness. I declare you free from sickness. In the name of Jesus, it is well with you. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying. Amen. I want you to just give God a good clap offering. Amen. Hallelujah. You can have your seat. I want to welcome us once again to another time together for fellowship. Another time together for fellowship. And we've started this journey that God has been taking us on, kingdom influence and dominion. It's our season of kingdom influence and dominion. And we have been looking at kings and priests. Kings and priests. That's our dual role that we have here. You know, last week I spoke about reigning in life by grace. The starting point, the entry point to the kingdom is grace. So that's why Ephesians chapter 2 verse 8 says, by grace you have been saved through faith. He said, this also, not of your work. It is by the grace of God. So it's a free gift. So grace is a gift that comes from God. Even faith is a gift. Even faith is a gift. Alright? But that's verse 8. So when we come to verse 10 of Ephesians chapter 2, then God gave us a purpose. He said, we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto every good works that God has ordained from the foundation of the world that we should walk in. So God didn't just save us so that we can jump and go to heaven. He saved us because there is an assignment that he has in mind. There is a purpose that he has in mind. So that's why when we understand grace, we must balance it up with kingdom. I've seen a lot of people, they are just saved. Then they are waiting for the rapture to come so that they can just escape. No, what about the kingdom? Until you understand the kingdom, your purpose will be a mystery to you. You will not understand what is your purpose because your purpose is trapped in an understanding of the kingdom of God. Until somebody understands what the message of the kingdom is, you will not fulfill purpose. Your purpose is more than having a job. It's more than having money. Your purpose is more than just living day to day and wondering what else am I supposed to be doing. No, there is a kingdom plan that God has. So that's why there is no dream, there is no vision that anybody has. It has to be within the umbrella of the kingdom, because that's where your purpose is hidden. When you understand the kingdom, your purpose is unveiled to you. That's why Paul, he was doing a lot of things in ignorance. He has passion, he has everything. He was doing a lot of things he didn't understand what he has been called to do, but he has an encounter. That was salvation in Acts chapter 9. The first thing he did was to have an encounter with Jesus. And he said, you have been persecuting me. He said, who are you? He said, I am Jesus. He was persecuting the believer. He didn't know that he was supposed to be part of them. So Jesus appeared to him, and then he gave his life to Christ. But that was not the end point. Later on, Jesus now blind his eyes and then open it up and begin to tell him all the things that he need to do. He said, I have called you for this purpose. So when you read Acts chapter 26, Acts 9 verse 26, then Paul began to expose us to the encounter that he has in 3 days. And he said, God said, I have ordained you for this purpose, to turn men from darkness unto light, from the kingdom of Satan unto God. So until a man meet God, his purpose cannot be fulfilled. So this series, we have gone through about six different messages. My wife and Cornelius have also come in. So today I want to just speak to us on becoming a kingdom influencer. Becoming a kingdom influencer. Now, that's very, very critical. So in the next 3 weeks, okay, the remaining part of this series is going to be focused on kingdom influence. Kingdom influence. Because that's our assignment here. That's why we are here. That's why God left us here. He left us here so that we can expand the kingdom and become an influencer. So becoming a kingdom influencer. There are two scriptures that I'm going to read to lay the foundation for today's message. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 to 7, and 2 Kings chapter 5, verse 1 to 16. That's a long text, but we are just going to read it, and then we'll extract a few things later from there. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 to 7. The Bible says, for unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given. So this is prophecy of Isaiah regarding Jesus. And he said that government will be upon his shoulders. I want you to take note of that. He's talking about a governmental structure. Speaking about Jesus. When he comes, he will bring a government. But that government will be where? On his shoulder. Where is your shoulder? It's part of your body. Your shoulder is not on your head, right? So it's part of your body. So if the government will be on the shoulder of Christ, who are those body of Christ? We are the body. So it means he came to introduce the government, but eventually we are the one that will expand that government structure. And it will be called Wonderful Counselor, Almighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Then in verse 7, he said, of the increase. So that means those governments meant to increase and expand. He said, of the increase of his government and peace. So because he also came to introduce peace unto men, there will be no end. So that means there is no limit to where that government will have impact and rulership. There is no limit. Everywhere there is human being, that government needs to spread in there. It will reign over the throne of David and over his kingdom, and to establish and sustain it with justice. It brings justice and righteousness from that time and forevermore. And he said, the seal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's hold that and go to 2 Kings chapter 5, verse 1 to 16. 2 Kings chapter 5, verse 1 to 16. That's a popular story of Naaman. Naaman and the slave girl. Now Naaman was commander of the army of the king of Aram. So this is a leader. He was a great man in the sight of his master and highly regarded. This is a reputable man too. Because through him the Lord has given victory to Aram. So that means he has some success credentials. He was a valiant soldier, but he had leprosy. Now, the bands of raiders from Aram had gone out and taken captive a young girl from Israel, and Shishar, Naaman's wife. Shishar, Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, if only my master will see the prophet who is in Samaria, he will cure him of his leprosy. I like the way they get talk. If only. I'm just giving you suggestion. It's up to you. I'm not forcing you. You know, the thing about the believer is that we are not meant to force people. God gave us the power of choice. So a lot of people, they want to coerce people. That's witchcraft. The moment you want to manipulate people so that they do what you want, is witchcraft. But you can bring suggestions to people. You can suggest. So if only he can do it, it's up to him. Naaman went to his master and told him what the guest said from Israel. By all means, go, the king of Aram replied. I will send a letter to the king of Israel. So Naaman left, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of clothing. The letter that he took to the king of Israel read, with this letter, I'm sending my servant Naaman to you so that you may cure him of his leprosy. As soon as the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his robe and said, am I God? Can I kill and bring back to life? Why does this fellow send someone to me to be cured of his leprosy? You see, sometimes we are looking for answer in the wrong place. We think because somebody has a title, because he has a position, he must have all the answers. No, there are some problems that the people of the world, they can't kill. There are some problems that would defy all human logic. You need to be connected to the Spirit of God to have that answer. And that's the reason why we are here. Because there are things that human wisdom, human talent, human money cannot buy. That the church is the only one that is uniquely called to fix. Imagine if there is no prophet. Naaman's case is sealed because the king cannot help. How he is trying to pick a quarrel with me. That's the king now. When Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel has torn his robe, he sent him this message. Why have you torn your robes? You know, whenever a king tore his robe, it means he's angry, he's frustrated. In the Bible, anywhere the king tore his robe, it means it's frustrated. Have the man come to me, and he will know there is a prophet in Israel. So Naaman went with his horses and chariot and stopped at the door of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to him. Go wash yourself 7 times in Jordan, and your flesh will be restored, and you'll be cleansed. But Naaman went away angry and said, I thought that he would surely come to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the spot and cure me of my leprosy. Are not Abama and Pama, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Couldn't I have washed in them and be cleansed? So he turned and went off in a rage. Naaman's servant went to him and said, my father, if the prophet had told you to do some great things, would you not have done it? Another word come from his servant. How much more? Then, when he tells you, wash and be clean. Okay, verse 14. So he went down and dipped himself in Jordan 7 times, and as the man of God has told him, and his flesh was restored, and he became clean, like that of a young boy. Then Naaman and all his attendants went back to the man of God. He stood before him and said, now, you see the conclusion, now I know there is no God in all the world except in Israel. You need, until we begin to make impact, and people say, we cannot find any other place where we can get the solution. Now I know that there is a God. You see, every knee must bow. Every tongue must confess that Jesus is Lord. This is an unbeliever now confessing that now I know, because I've experienced it. Now I know that there is a God. There is no God in all the world except in Israel. So please accept a gift from your servant. Verse 16, the prophet answered, I saw it as the Lord live, whom I serve, I will not accept a thing. Why? It's not about money. It's not about money. It's not about money. And even though Naaman urged him, he refused. May the Lord bless the reading of his word in our hearts. Now, today we want to talk about becoming a kingdom influencer. Becoming a kingdom influencer. And the first thing that probably we want to do is to just discover who a kingdom influencer is. Who an influencer is. Now, if you look at the first text that we read, it indicates that Jesus did not come to introduce religion. Jesus did not come to start another religion. There are already religious people during his time. What he came to introduce is a kingdom. He came to introduce the kingdom to man. That's why all the teachings that Jesus did, he was teaching them in parables, the parables of the kingdom. Now, the reason why he's teaching them in parable is because parables are just like stories. People connect more with stories. They understand things when you tell them in story form. You use an illustration. You say, this thing is like. You see, stories are the ways that you break complex things down, because nobody has seen the kingdom before. Nobody has know what the kingdom is. So when he's trying to explain what the kingdom is, he has to use parables, because they can relate with some of those parables. And because most of them are farmers during his day, most of his parables are agricultural in nature, because that is what they can understand. But what he came to introduce is a kingdom. He came to give them a new way of life, a new style of life. And that's why all his teaching are based on the kingdom. I remember a time he was talking to the disciples. He said, it is given unto you to understand the mystery. Because the kingdom comes as a mystery to people. They could not understand it. He said, it is given. So when he's speaking in parable, the disciples too, they got confused at the time. They wouldn't understand it. He said, what is the meaning of all this parable? For example, in Mark chapter 4, so when he was giving them the parable of the sower, they were confused. They didn't understand what he's talking about. They said, what is all this parable that you are talking about? He said, it is given unto you to understand it. To them it's not given. And the reason why, as believers, we need to understand what the kingdom is because you cannot expand the kingdom of God until you understand what the kingdom is about. So it is because they are the one that will be commissioned to expand the reach of that governmental structure. So he has to sit down with them and teach them and explain it to them so that they can understand. And he said, it's given unto us to understand it. So the kingdom is the main mission why Jesus came. That's the mandate that brought him. That's the mandate that brought him. So who is an influencer? That's the first thing before I actually go for that to talk about the kingdom mission. Who is an influencer? Let's just have a definition. And I check, I think it's Wikipedia or so where I got this. He said, an influencer is someone or something that has the potential to impact, change, or shape the perspectives, opinion, and behaviors of something or someone. Anything that has the potential or the ability to change or shape the opinion and behavior of someone or something is influential. And in the days of social media that we are in now, there is a rise of social media influencers and marketers. They are actually tapping into those potentials to market products. In fact, Facebook currently have over 2 billion, I think, 2 billion users. And they said they have almost 3 million influencers. I mean, they have a benchmark of how many number of followers you need to have for you to be called an influencer. But the thing is that companies, they discover that if they just do an ad, they just post an ad on social media, the tendency for people to buy it is very low. Why? Because people only buy from what they know or who they know. So now what they do is they will hire somebody who is an influencer and say, just talk about this, our product. You see a lot of them on YouTube. They will talk about something you think they have used it. Many times they have not used it. They are just marketers. They are just there to promote it because they know that you will make a decision because you trust those people. And that's what many of them are doing. I remember Apple. Apple wanted to start Apple Books. Apple Books, they want to be selling books on their platform in Apple Store. Who did they hire? They hire Oprah Winfrey. And Oprah now started a book club. So any book that Oprah recommends, everybody in that book club, they buy it. Can you imagine millions of people buying the book? The book is it's going to be a bestseller. So it's influencers, social media influencers, because they know those people, they can shape the behavior. They can shape the opinion of people to take an action. To take an action. So when we also talk about the kingdom is about influence. The kingdom is about influence, impacting somebody, influencing somebody in the direction of God. Because influence can be both positive and negative. Okay? Negative influences. That's what we don't want to have. But influence can also be positive. That means through your influence, you can bring out the best in somebody. You can help somebody to discover something that they never knew existed. That's an influence. So influencers, those are the people that God is relying on to carry his message unto all over the world. And we are going to see how this thing works in a kingdom setting. Now it differs from the world. It differs from the world because God has called every one of us to become a kingdom influencer. Even if it is one person that you can influence. Even if it is one person that you can touch, it's okay. You see, because for me, if only one person needs salvation, Jesus will still come and he will still die. That is why he said, if you have 100 sheep and 99 of them are okay and one is lost, he said, you leave the 99 and you run after one. That is how precious every soul is to God. So if God has positioned you in a place where even it's only one person, you fulfill a purpose in God's agenda. So the kingdom mission of Jesus, the kingdom mission of Jesus. Now, I'd like us to also define the word kingdom. The word kingdom. Now, Miles Monroe is one of my favorite mentors in the area of kingdom. And he has two definitions that I want to share with us. Number one, what is a kingdom? A kingdom, he defined a kingdom as the sovereign rulership and governing influence of a king over his territory, impacting it with his will, his intent, and his purpose, manifesting a culture. So you see the word intent, purpose, culture. Those are the things that the kingdom bring. The kingdom bring the will of the king. The kingdom bring the purpose of the king. The kingdom bring the culture of the king. That's why when British people, when they come to Africa, to colonize Africa, what did they do? They introduced British culture. That's why when you go to any school in Nigeria, you might not even be able to speak the local language. But which language will you have to speak? English. You have to speak English. How about the way we dress in Nigeria? It was when I left Nigeria that I know that not all the white people say are putting on tie. When I was in Nigeria, you want to make a presentation in the university, you have to put on your shoe and tie. They said it's formal. You have to dress formal. Who bring those culture? It is the colonial masters. So anywhere you have a governmental influence, you will see a change in culture, a change in purpose, a change in direction of how they do things. And so kingdom is also about introducing the culture and the lifestyle of heaven into the domain of men. So that's why the first message, we are touching heaven as a priest, but we are also changing hearts as a king. We are bringing the influence of the kingdom into the society. So the society that we live in, the goal is that they should reflect the purpose of God. They should reflect the will of God. They should reflect the culture of God's kingdom. And the primary thing in that kingdom is love. The primary lifestyle, and I'm going to share more on that, is love. You see, the world is full of hatred. We need an mentality. The world is full of darkness. We need a light that will shine. That's why you cannot let the world influence you negatively. You cannot talk like them. You cannot talk like them. The way that the world talk is to talk people down. You cannot allow the spirit of the world to rule you. We might be in the world, but we are not of it. That means we carry a different spirit. All right? So that's the first definition. The second one is also similar. It said a kingdom is the governing impact of a king over a territory or domain, is influence over a people and government led by a king. So Jesus is the king of kings. And we are just a king in that kingdom. And he has put the government on our shoulder. The kingdom is a governmental structure. So that government rests on his shoulder, which is his body. And through the body, we are supposed to spread the influence. He said, of the increase of that government, there will be no end. So anywhere that we go, we carry that influence. Everywhere that we go. Everywhere. We are supposed to spread it. How far the gospel will spread, how far the kingdom is going to spread, is up to us. It's up to us. Because he has given us power. He has given us the authority to be his ambassador, to represent him everywhere that we go. So, that's the mandate that Jesus came to bring. And sometimes, when you begin to talk about the kingdom, when you are introducing a new kingdom, it's likely to be contradictory to the culture or the norm that already exists. So that's why when Jesus came, he has struggled with religious people, he has struggled with traditional people. Okay? They have a Jewish culture. They have some traditions. They have some things. In fact, when they were doing Passover at the time, they said, you are supposed to go. His brother was advising him. You are supposed to go for the Passover festival. Because religion is not about observing events, activities, without life. Jesus said, no, I'm the bread. That Passover bread that you are eating, I'm the bread. The bread that your forefather ate in the wilderness, I'm actually that bread. I said, you are crazy. They said, you are crazy. I said, what do you mean the bread? You know, and it is because he's speaking a language that is contradictory to the norm, to what they think, to what they believe, and he's trying to introduce something in. And you know that the thing is that all through the time that Jesus came, even people around him, they didn't believe him. His own brother James didn't believe him. It was after he died that James became a believer. So one of the things that you might also encounter is that we live in a culture that is not godly, a culture that is not friendly to the kingdom. How do we live as kingdom people in a culture that is opposed to what you believe? I'm going to be sharing on that in the third part of this series. How to bring the culture of the kingdom. And Daniel is my role model. in that sense. Daniel lived in a country that doesn't believe what he believed. In fact, because he believed in something, he suffered for it. At one time, he said, okay, you should not pray. And Daniel said, how can I not pray? What did they do? They said, we will throw you in the lion's den if you don't keep your mouth shut and stop praying. There are some things that are non-negotiable. So how do you bring the culture of the kingdom in an hostile society? I'm going to be sharing some things that God shared with me in the third part. Then next week, I'm going to be talking about using your influence and position for kingdom influence. And Esther is our case study on that. You see, anytime God promotes you, he puts you in a particular position, it is for a kingdom purpose. It is for there is a special favor of God that he put on those that have a kingdom mind. That's why if you look at Joseph, why did God promote him to be there? It is for a kingdom purpose. So how do you leverage on position? Because we need to be in some position. We are not in some position, so we cannot make decisions because we don't have influence. We need people who are going to go into some position, like Esther, so that where they are making that decision on what to be done, there is a voice that we have there. So how can we leverage on positions and power as kingdom people to influence the decision makers? I'm going to be talking on that next week. But today, we are dealing with everybody has influence. Everybody. Whether you know it or not, you have influence. So the kingdom of God is about influence. It's a governmental system where the values, the will, and the lifestyle of heaven dominate and permeate the affairs of men on earth. It's about influence. And I like the way John Maxwell defined leadership. You see, the church is supposed to be taking the lead, right? Because we are the light. Light means leadership. Because people cannot walk when there is darkness. But light shows us direction, where to go. So the church is supposed to take the lead. And if we are going to be leader, the leadership style of the kingdom differs from the world. And the world is about being a boss. It's about lording yourself over people. But in the kingdom, the leader is the one that is serving. So it's a different lifestyle. So when you are a kingdom leader, your role is different from the role of a boss in the world. It's different. So that's what Jesus brings. It's counterculture. And so if we want to walk by God's kingdom lifestyle, we must understand some of these principles. That's why he teach all of the principles. That's why all of the teachings that Jesus did in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John was to give us a new lifestyle. You remember in Matthew chapter 5, he said, you have heard what was said in those days, that an eye for an eye. If somebody offends you, just curse the person and say the person should die. He said, no, I'm bringing a new lifestyle. He said, love your enemy. Pray for those who hurt you. And do good to those who despise you. Are you kidding? You mean I shouldn't call somebody that is cursing me? He said, when you do all of these things, there are people who know that you are the sons and daughters of your father in heaven. Are you kidding? It's a new lifestyle. So that's why we've got to understand it. That the world we are living in, the lifestyle of the world or the culture of the world, does not support some of the things that Jesus asked us to do. And if we are going to become an influencer, then we must be the difference that we want to see in the world. We must have a different approach. And I'm going to share a little bit more on that when we talk about culture. Okay, because there are some metrics that we need to watch out for if we are going to be the difference in the world. I will share more on that. Okay, so the kingdom rests on us. The increase of that kingdom to the end of the earth is through the body of Christ. And we spread the kingdom influences to the various spheres of life. That's why the Bible says we are the salt of the earth and light of the world. So without the church, the kingdom cannot spread because the kingdom, the governing structure, rests on the shoulder of the body. Okay? And so the church has a primary role to extend that kingdom to the hands of the heart. So, I want to speak on how to bring kingdom influences beyond the walls of church building. How to bring kingdom influences. Because the second story that we read actually shows us that the kingdom influence is meant to go beyond the wall of the church. Even though I didn't like that story because, I mean, it's child trafficking. If we are going to use modern day language, it's child trafficking that happened in 2 Kings chapter 5. They came and they just took over the girl. I don't like that experience. But you see, even from things that doesn't seem good, God still find a way to fulfill the kingdom purpose. Because I can assume, I can imagine, if that lady has not been in the vicinity of Naaman, he cannot introduce the solution. And so sometimes, men might do wicked things to you. Men might do things that are ungodly to you. But you see, the Bible says all things are working together for the good of those that love God and those who are called according to his purpose. Now, God is not the author of evil, but God can use evil to still fulfill his agenda. That's why God does not like the fact that they threw Joseph in the pit. God does not like the fact that they wanted to kill Joseph. God does not like the fact that his brother sold him into slavery. But you see, everything eventually worked together to fulfill God's purpose. One of the mysteries that we will never understand is the mystery of God's purpose. Because sometimes we like things that are just falling in line correctly. But there are things that will not fall in line that is part of the plan. Because God knows how to take even the things that are your pain, even the things that are your discomfort, he knows how to map everything together to fulfill a purpose for your life. So, I believe that this girl was strategically positioned in a place where it could offer help to somebody that is dying and is in need. Okay? And I believe that our picture is the picture of a believer. God will take us out of our comfort zone. That's why the command that Jesus gave to us to expand the kingdom is that we should go. We should go into all the world. And unfortunately, the church is sitting down. Rather than going, we are sitting down. We are supposed to go. Because when we begin to leave our comfort zone, we are able to reach the world, beyond the world of the church. So this girl, for me, I believe is a picture of the ministry that every believer has. So that's why the only minister is not somebody who preach on Sunday. It's not a pastor. It's not your reverend. It's not your bishop. Everybody is a minister. Because ministry is just any avenue that you have to serve humanity. So this girl ministered to Laban. So the first key point for today is that the church is strategically positioned in the world to bring answers to the problems in the world. That's the first thing that I want us to bear in mind. The church is strategically positioned in the world to bring answers to the problem in the world. Now, you see, Naaman would have died in leprosy. Naaman would have died. He has every other thing checked. He's a powerful man. He's a man with a lot of results. He's a man that is respected. He's a man that has all the regards. He has everything. Career, good. Everything good. But yet, there's still something missing that he could not face. You see, sometimes we look at the people of the world. We look at so-called people, highly placed people, and we think everything is okay. But there's still something. Some of them, they don't have peace of mind. Some of them, they can't sleep. Some of them, they are tormented in their... Can you imagine? We are watching some movie now. You see, a lot of these people, they draw a lot of audience in those movies. But yet, you will hear that some of them commit suicide. How can somebody who is raking millions... Money is not his problem, because we thought money can be solved problem. Money is not his problem. How can he wake up and now commit suicide? It is because without God, you are still empty. So even though Naaman check all the box up for success, for riches, for wealth, for position, for power, for everything, he has everything. But there is still a but. There is still a but. It took a young girl to point it out and say, this is where the answer is. You see, I believe that the role of the church is strategic. God has positioned us that there are some problems that nobody will be able to fix until you show up. That's why when Joseph showed up, he said, appoint a man. He didn't mention himself. He said, appoint a man. Let him do this. Let him do that. They said, where can we find that kind of person? In whom the Spirit of the Lord is. So that means there is a wisdom. There is a wisdom that God can give a believer to address a problem that other people will be looking at the same thing, they cannot find what's the answer. So this girl came in, and the leprosy that Naaman has been dealing with for many years, this girl came with an answer. And not only that, when they wrote the letter, they wrote it to the king of Israel. And so Naaman didn't go to the prophet directly, he went to the king. And the king said, oh, this is a setup. This is a setup, oh, I'm in trouble. Where will I get that kind of answer? You see, even people that are in power, they know there are some problems that they cannot fix. That's why for me, when COVID began to occur, I know that there are some problems that defy human logic. Because even many of the leaders, they will tell you something today, tomorrow, it's another thing. Because they've never seen it before. They don't have the answer. But you see, the Holy Spirit knows what man does not know. So that's why one of the assets that we have is that we have access to the wisdom of God. We have access to the Holy Spirit, and we can know things that are not in the realm of human understanding. So in your place of work, in your daily work, there is an influence of the Holy Spirit on everything that you do. So you have to be conscious of that. I'm not just doing what I'm doing because I have some education. There is a part that my education played, but that's not the only reason. That's not where my creativity comes from. My creativity comes from the Holy Spirit, because there is a spirit in man. The inspiration of the Almighty give him understanding. Sometimes I will just sit down. Ideas will be flooding like river in my own head. Where is the idea coming from? I don't even know, but I know that I have a spirit that talk to me. So for me, when I sit down, the first thing I do is I just pray in the spirit. I say, Holy Spirit, oh yeah, I want to do this slide. Oh, you see all my slides, they are shining, right? I don't just do them. I just sit down. I say, Holy Spirit, give me some thought on what I should do. And I will just discover that the Holy Spirit will just be telling me what to do strategically. So there's something about the church that we have never discovered, is that we are strategically positioned. In fact, if you look at all the words that God used to describe the church, is to tell us the impact that we're supposed to make. We're supposed to be the salt. We're supposed to be the light. And the Bible says we are also a nation. We are also mountain. In Isaiah chapter 2, verse 2, he said, in the last day, the mountain of the Lord's temple will be established as the highest mountain. So we are not going to be hidden. It will be the highest. People will be looking up to the church. You remember I preached a message on Acts chapter 3. When a world in need meets a church that is ready to help. You see, there are problems that the world has that the church is the one that they are looking to for answer. So I want you to unlock the Holy Spirit's work in you, because there is a problem that the world have that they have not been able to find answers, that the Holy Spirit will begin to reveal to you. Amen? So, he said the mountain will be exalted above all the east, and all nations will stream to it. They will be coming to you for answers. They will be looking to you. That is what Naaman did. He left Aram, his own country, and came all the way to Israel. He said, I need answers to this problem that I'm facing. We are supposed to be leading and showing the world that there is answer to this thing. So that's the first thing. The second point I want to bring out is that everyone has influence. Everyone. Everyone has influence. Our levels and spheres of influence may differ. But everyone. There is no one that doesn't have influence. If you look at this girl, she doesn't have title. She doesn't have position. She doesn't have anything. But she has influence. In fact, sociologists say that even an introvert, people who don't talk, they actually have influence, that in their lifetime, they are likely to influence close to 10,000 people. Directly or indirectly, they are likely to influence close to 10,000 people. So everybody has influence. And let's note, kingdom influence is not a position. Kingdom influence is not fame. It's not, we are not talking social media. Kingdom influence is not how much money you have. It's not wealth. Kingdom influence is about impact on another person's life. Okay? So you can have money, you can have position, you can have fame, but yes, you are not having kingdom influence. Okay? It is only when your life is impacting others to conform to the pattern of the kingdom. That's when you are having kingdom influence. Okay? So, we all have influence. This girl has no name. We don't even know her name, but she made an influence on a general, on a big man. He made an influence. Can you imagine? That's very important. So influence is in levels. Influence is in levels. So it starts with you. Because until you are also influenced by Christ, you cannot influence others. That's why Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. To the degree that I also follow Christ as a disciple, that's the degree that you can follow. That's why when God gives us a template for love, He didn't just tell us love in theory. He gave us a model. He said we should be imitators of Christ. Ephesians chapter 5. Before He now says, husband, love your wife. In verse 20. People like to quote the latter verse in verse 22 and 23. But it starts from verse 1. He first gave us, He said we should imitate Christ. Because Christ didn't love us for what He would get. And He gave us the template, the sample for that love. So we can only imitate people based on how they imitate Christ. So it starts with you. If your life has been changed by God's love, if your life has been touched by God's love, if your life has been impacted by God's love, then you start to make influence with others. Because then your life will no longer be about you. So it starts with you. Then the next level is your family. Because influence grows from inward outward. So the closer people are to you, the more influence you have on their life. The people that spend so much time with you, they are the ones that you have the most influence over. Okay? So it starts with you, it goes to your family, it goes to your neighbor. People in your neighborhood, I know some people in Canada, they don't talk to their neighbor. But you can impact your neighbor. So that's what I'm saying. So just say, hello, hello neighbor, who I've not seen you for 4 months. Because indirectly or directly, when you are coming in, when you are going out, they are looking at your life. And there is something that they have been seeing about you that makes you different. Okay, then you come to the church, then you go to your workplace, then you have your city, and you have the nation. So it starts little with you, and it can grow upward like that. Okay, you can grow it by creating more connection with people. Another thing that you should know is the mountain of influence, which was created around 1970s. The mountain of influence. So apart from the levels to which you influence people, so somebody might just be a mom and ask just one child, do you know that you influence the future of that one child? And if you can successfully do that in God's agenda, you have fulfilled your purpose. Don't worry about the rest of the world. You are not Jesus. You are not called to save the whole world. But you are called to influence at least people around you in your circle of influence. So even if it is your family member that you are impacting and influencing in God's agenda, that is very good. Because if everybody influences family for God, then the whole world will be saved by now. The whole world will be saved by now. So there are 7 mountains of influence that the church needs to be involved in. Unfortunately, the church is withdrawing from all these areas. So we only concentrate on church. But if we are not there, this is where the culture of the society is being formed. This is where people's ideologies are being formed. This is where the philosophies of life of people are being shaped. So if we are not there, then we are going to miss it because it will be too late before we catch up. So education, religion, family, government, business, art and entertainment, those are the seven mountains. So where has God called you to influence? Where has God called you? You've got to decide. For me, I'm an educator. And I'm in business. Family man. Okay, I'm not called to government. So maybe before Jesus comes, maybe I might be a politician, but not now. I'm not called to government. But I'm just saying that for many of us, we are so restricted to the traditional definition of who a minister is, that when they say, oh, art and entertainment, we don't see that as a calling. And you see, the thing is that Jesus said we should go into all the world and bring the kingdom influence into them. Look at how many people watch movie on Netflix and go and look at all the movie, what they are teaching them. It's not kingdom. So why are we not going to be there? Because that's where the beliefs are formed. You are preaching the Bible. They are not even opening the Bible. They are looking at what they see on Netflix and forming opinion. So we should package the message in a way that where people are, that is where we are putting the message. So as a church, our job is to bring that influence to every sphere of our life. And we have to be very strategic. So this girl didn't just wait for Naaman to come. In fact, the time they went to Israel before, they went there to destroy them. But she came all the way to Naaman's house and she made an influence. So this mountain of influence is very important. And one of the things that we want to also do, if we are going to have influence in those areas, is that there must be proper equipping and training. You know, when God was telling the children of Israel to go to the promised land, and I believe that the church is in the wilderness, we have not gotten to the promised land. He told them the promised land has seven mountains. And that seven mountains is being occupied by giants currently. One of the seven mountains is Canaan. Canaan is the center of economy, so it represents business in those days. So when he asked them, he said, go and take over that mountain. Do you know that when they send the spies, some of them see the people that are there, they say, that place is closed. We can't go there because the giants are there. All these places that we are talking about too, there are giants. So don't expect that things are going to just fall on your lap. But the thing is that we have to train the believers to be able to go in there. That's why the Bible told Jesus spent 3.5 years to disciple. He mentored them. He taught them how to operate in the lifestyle of the kingdom so that they can function. And that's the job of the church. He said we should equip people for the work of the ministry. The work of the ministry is not the church. Our job here is to equip believers for the work of the ministry. The mission field is outside the world of the church. So the kind of training, equipping that we are given in the church must prepare them for every sphere of influence in life. If we are going to have believers speaking as God's voice. For example, in our own days, people like Esther will not be recognized as a kingdom influencer. You are going for art and entertainment, beauty pageant. No, that is not a ministry. But that is what God used as a tool to save an entire nation from genocide. So let's rethink our idea of ministry and influence and see that the kingdom is all about bringing the lifestyle and the culture of heaven. You know the one that was reading before Esther, fasting, proud, arrogant. But God needs somebody who is God-fearing, who will do the will of God to be in that position. And she was dethroned because of pride. And God opened the door for his own. Favor will put you in position that you never thought possible. But it is because God has an agenda that he wants to operate with your life. So the second point is that we all have influence. Your influence might not be the same as mine because we are called to different spheres of influence, or your influence might not be the same as mine because you are just called to the family, to influence the family, but we all have influence. Even if it is one friend that you have, what kind of influence are you having over that person? Now, if you are not influencing the person, then indirectly the person is influencing you. There's no new treasure. Because the goal of the salt is to influence something, right? When the salt contacts something, it will influence it. So if you are not influencing it, the Bible says if a salt is not making something salty, then it's not even of any use. It's like putting it on the ground and we step on it. So if we are not influencing anything, that thing is actually influencing us. Number three point, because of our time. Number three, you cannot influence or impact anything you don't interact with or touch. Anything that you don't interact with or touch, you cannot influence it. Anything. So that's why until you touch something, you cannot influence it. You know, the thing that Jesus did, the religious people in his day, they criticized him for it. For example, in Mark chapter 2, verse 13 to 17, I don't have it on the slide, the Bible says, once again, Jesus went out beside the lake. A large crowd came to him, and he began to teach. As he walked along, he saw Levi, son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax collector's booth. Follow me, Jesus told him, and Levi got up and followed him. While Jesus was having dinner at Levi's house, you know, Levi is not somebody that you interact with. He's a corrupt guy. He's a corrupt guy. Tax collectors, they are not people that you want to interact with. So, but the Bible says, as he was sitting for dinner, so Jesus even went to his house. Because you cannot change anything you don't interact with. These are people that the society doesn't want to interact with. He's a corrupt guy. But Jesus went to his house. As he was sitting down, the Bible says, many tax collectors and sinners were eating with him and his disciples. For they were many who followed him. When the teachers of the law, you see the religious people? When the teachers of the law, who were Pharisees, saw him eating with the sinners and tax collectors, they asked his disciples, why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners? On hearing this, Jesus said to them, it is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners. You see, many of us, we have isolated ourselves from the people that we are meant to impact. We only talk to people who talk in tongues, who speak in tongues. So when we get to the office, we don't even talk to anybody. But you see, you cannot impact or influence anybody that you don't talk to. I remember one day I was talking to one of the managers that I've worked with on the place of work. And then I like to just ask personal questions. Is your family, you know? Just ask personal questions just to connect. And then he said, yeah, I've been having some back pain, you know? He said, I've been having some back pain. I said, oh, what's going on? He said, he doesn't know that he has tried so many things. It didn't work. I said, can we go to the kitchen? You know, we have a kitchen area. I said, can we go to the kitchen? He said, yeah. So, and then we were there. I said, the guy is an Hindu guy. I said, if you don't mind, can I hold your hand and play with you? He said, well, it doesn't work. You see, when people have problems, they want the answer. Wherever the answer comes from, they don't care. And that's why there are some things that will happen in the marketplace that will not happen in church. There are some deliverance that will only happen in the marketplace that will not happen in church. Why? Because the presence of God is not church. The presence of God is the heart of the believer. And anywhere the believer goes, we carry it there. We become the carrier of the presence of God. So anywhere we go, the power of God is available in them. So whether it's your workplace or in the church, the same healing that happened in the church can happen there. So that's how I pray with the guy. That's how I pray with the guy. So we have people who need help. There are people that are thinking of suicide around you. That maybe it's just connecting with them and talking to them that will open the door. So the religious people in Jesus' day, their own idea is you don't interact with tax collectors and sinners. But those are the people that Jesus said have come to serve. I need to talk to them because you cannot change anything. You cannot impact anything that you don't touch. A salt cannot impact or change anything that it doesn't touch. So that's why when we withdraw from some of these mountains of influence, then we have already given the authority that God gave to us, to the enemy. So that's why the Bible says, when the righteous are in authority, what happened? People rejoice. But when the wicked are the one ruling, what happened? There's mourning. We can complain from now to tomorrow about what is wrong, but only leaders take action. So let's take the lead. Number four, because of time. Influence is not just top down, but bottom up. Influence is not just top down, but bottom up. You see, I come from African culture, right? African culture is the boss. Then when the boss talk, who are you to talk? Who are you to talk back? You cannot talk. And so many of us, we've grown up with that mindset that you have nothing to offer. So when somebody is talking, you cannot give advice. But this girl, a slave girl, nameless girl, she demonstrated to us that even the people that we thought are high up there, they need help. They need help. So just a word of advice, just a word of encouragement can go a long way. And that's why good leaders, they surround themselves with good thinkers. Good leaders, they don't do all the work. Good leaders, they surround themselves with smart people. And they call them advisors. Go and look at American president, how many advisors he has. He has advisors on everything, including the food that he's going to eat. There is somebody doing that thinking for him and telling him, this is what you eat for breakfast. This is what you eat for lunch. That is to tell you that he is just in the position. But he needs feedback. He needs people that are under him to give input for decision making. So, wherever you are working, the person that you are working with does not know everything. He doesn't have all the knowledge. He doesn't have all the ideas. God doesn't concentrate his wisdom in one person. So, he needs your input. He needs your feedback. So, that's why influence is not just bottom up. It's not top down. It's also bottom up. As a kid, you can influence your parents. As a kid, do you know they listen to you? When you say, I want to buy an iPad, your parent is running a task getter trying to get the iPad for you. That's influence. That's influence. The day you tell them you need the iPad, they are having sleepless nights looking for where to get the money. That's influence. Now, if somebody else that they don't know, tell them, get me iPad, you think they will have sleepless nights? They won't care about it. So, but that's to tell you that we all have influence. We all have influence. So it's not just your parents that is influencing you. You are also influencing them. When you are in your place of work, it's not the boss that is influencing you. You are also influencing the person. So one thing that the Holy Spirit speaks to me on this thing is don't withdraw advice. Now, be very careful when you are talking that you are not trying to manipulate or coerce. This girl did not do that. What did she do? He said, only if. So she gave a suggestion and leave the man to make a decision. He said, only if Naaman will go to Israel, he will be healed. He will be healed. Only if. And that's very important, that you give your advice and let the person make a decision on what you want to do. But your voice is important. It's very vital. When you see something that you think, maybe this thing will benefit this person, don't hide it. Don't hide it. Now, it's up to the person. There are people who are so arrogant and proud. When you give them advice, what do you know? That you are telling me what to do. I've been in this position for 50 years. Don't you know I'm the boss here? It's up to him. But you have done your part. Your part is to ensure that when you see something that is beneficial, you release it. It's very important. Everywhere you go, always have that open mind. Don't just go with the crowd. Always have that open mind. When you have an idea or a thought about something, release it. Every leader needs people around him to be smart. Every leader. Every good leader. Let me say that. Every good leader. Because not all leaders not all leaders like correction. So every good leader They are open to feedback. They are open to feedback. Even in relationship, one of the things that sabotage relationship is when the man think I'm the leader here, and his definition of leadership is boss. My wife cannot tell me anything. How can my wife be telling me what I should do? The moment you get to that point, pride sets in. And pride always comes before the fall. But what God wants us to do is a leader that is based on kingdom style, which is you are open to feedback. That's why Jesus asked his disciples, what do men think that I am? He was looking for feedback. So as a good leader, you've got to know that influence is not top down, it's also bottom up. So God has placed people in your life because he sees your need. That's why the reason why God gave the woman to the man is because man has a need. So are you open to receive the help that God has placed in your life? Or you are too proud that you know everything? So please, let's know that the strength of this particular church is in all of us bringing in all our ideas on board. The church is going to be weak if it's only centered around the thinking of one person. The church can only be strong when we all come with different ideas. And that's the way it's supposed to be. All right, number five, as we close. Number five, the kingdom is about influence, not affluence. It's about influence, not affluence. So success in the kingdom is different from the way the world measures success. In the world system, they measure success by how much dollar is in your account right now. But you can be doing child trafficking, you can be doing sex trade, and still have millions of dollars coming in into your account. In the eye of God, that's not success. It's failure. So as this man received his healing, then he wanted to give money to Elisha. And the man said, no, I'm not taking anything. The man begged. He said, please take it. He said, no, I'm not doing it for money. You see, one of the things that God will do before he trusts you with his influence, he will test your heart. He will test your heart. Now, when the motive of your heart is not about people, you will miss the plan that God has. And that's why the reason why we are pursuing kingdom agenda is not for ourselves. Number one, it's not also for money. A lot of people miss it. When they start ministry, their goal is to make people, to take money from people. That's not ministry. When we come into the kingdom is about service to people. Now, Jesus said, you cannot serve God and mammon in Matthew chapter 6. But it was immediately after that he now introduced the kingdom. He said, seek ye the kingdom, and all of these things will be added to you. Most of the things that people focus on that they are chasing, they are the things that God said he's going to have. And that's why when God blessed Peter in Luke chapter 5, God gave him a word and said, throw your net to this side. And he caught a big fish. The net broke. Do you know that immediately after, Jesus just used it to demonstrate that I will make you fishers of men. Immediately after, Jesus said, oh yeah, that's true. And be fishers of men. What did they do? They left everything. They left Eve and Peter. I would say, sorry, this blessing that you just gave me. Me, I'm not going anywhere. I've reached my promised land. I'm going to say. But that's the way God works. God doesn't want your heart to be corrupted by the blessing that he gave to you. For your heart to be about the kingdom. Yeah. When your heart is about the kingdom, every need that you have will be taken care of. But God wants you to know that the only thing that is his priority for your life is the kingdom. When you seek the kingdom, when your goal is to expand the influence of the kingdom, then in the midst of it, God will add everything that you need for your life as a blessing. There is nothing wrong in having money. There is nothing wrong in having all this blessing. But that's not our focus. Our focus is the kingdom. Everything that we do, the motivation for it is the expansion of the kingdom. The blessing is just a byproduct. It's not a goal. So that's why if your motive is not right, then the enemy will manipulate you. He will say, bow down for me and I will give you some dollars. And then you start doing things that are ungodly. You will not live in integrity. You will start manipulating. You start lying. You start doing things that contradict the kingdom that you say you stand for. That's not the will of God. So I want to just challenge us with that. So let's rise to our feet as we pray. Becoming a kingdom influencer. Can God trust you with his influence? He gave you his power. He gave you everything. What are you going to do with it? Who do you want to influence this week? It might just be a call. And you just say a word of encouragement to somebody. It might just be a call. That you just speak good to somebody. It might just be you just praying for somebody. That's ministry. The place where we are supposed to be ministering is outside the church. We are here to equip ourselves for the work of the ministry. There are people who are going through troubled times and they need help. God has placed you in a place where you can add value to them, where you can help. Even in your workplace, he said, whatsoever we do, we should do it with all our heart. He said, we should do it as unto God and not unto man. Because our reward can only come from God. Your employer cannot pay you what you are worth. But when God sees your heart, that your heart is there, your heart is to glorify God. Your purpose, the only reason why you work hard, was not for any fame, was not to get an award or recognition by your company, but to glorify God. Then God will promote you. It will take you beyond where your human skills or talent can take you. I want you to just speak into our lives as a ministry that we will represent everything that is kingdom values. Everything that is kingdom values. We will stand for kingdom values. We will be a touch bearer of God. We will be a source of influence in the society. We will be a source of influence to the whole world. Pray that God will use us as a vessel to expand his kingdom. That we will bring increase to the kingdom of God. Everywhere that we go, we will represent God. Father, we ask that you will help us as individuals and as a ministry. Everywhere that we go, that we will bring this influence of the kingdom into everywhere that we go in the name of Jesus. Thank you, dear Father. We give you praise. We honor you and we bless you. We appreciate you, God. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
I want us to just pray right now that God will open our eyes. Open our eyes to the needs around us. Open our eyes. You know, Cornelius read one scripture. He said, Jesus said, you said it's 4 months and then there will be harvest. He said, but no, open your eyes. The field is already ripe for harvest. The heart of men are already waiting. The only thing they are waiting is for the influencers to show up. I want you to just pray and say, Lord, open our eyes. Open our eyes to everyone that you have called us unto. Lord, open our eyes so that we might notice them. So that we might see them. We are not called to save the whole world. No, that's not our mission. But to the people that God has called us as a ministry, as individuals, to touch. Lord, open our eyes to see them, to locate them, to know where they are. It might just be our family member. It might be our loved one. It might be a friend. It might be a neighbor. It might be somebody that we have not even talked to in a while. For God is calling us to be a source of influence in the life of that person. Lord, open my eyes. Open my eyes. I want to see the people that you have called me into. Lord, I want to locate the people that you have called me into. I want to know the people that you have called me to influence. The kind of people that you have called me to speak a word into. Lord, I say you open my eyes, oh God. Open my eyes, oh God. Open my eyes. Open my eyes so that I can look at them. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I want to use the platform and the influence that you have given me for expanding the kingdom. For bringing the values of the kingdom into everyone that I come in contact with. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
One of the goals that God has for us is that we become like Jesus. God wants us to conform to the image. Give us an image of his son. And he wants us to conform to that image of his son. He proposed us in Romans chapter 8 to conform to the image of his son. Until you are changed, you can't change anybody.
Yes.
You can only give what you have. You can't give what you don't have. I want us to pray and say, Lord, transform me by your spirit. As I represent you. When people look at me, Jesus said, if you see me, you have seen the Father. They are asking, they say, where is the Father? Show us the Father. He said, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. When people see me, I want them to see Jesus. I want them to see Jesus in me. I want them to see the nature of God in me. I want them to see Christ manifested in my life. I want them to see the glory of the Lord in my life. The Bible says Christ in you is the hope of glory. I want them to see the glory of God manifested. I want them to see God through my life. When they are trying to find out who God is, when they look at me, I want them to see Jesus. I want them to see God. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name, we are prayed. Father, Lord, we thank you. And we give you all the praise and glory. Thank you for calling us according to your divine purpose. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Even in our seemingly discomfort, even when things are not the way we want it, your purpose can still manifest. Father, that's why sometimes when I look back, I thank you for disappointments. I thank you for rejections. I thank you for things that didn't even work the way I wanted. Because I can look back now and I see that all things work together for good to them that love God and to them that are called according to his purpose. Thank you for raising us up as kingdom influencers. Thank you for putting the government on our shoulder so that we can carry it into the hands of the world, into every nooks and corners of the world, so that we can serve God and bring his impact into every domain that you have called us to. Lord, we submit all our gifts, all our talents, all our platforms, everything that we have, we submit it unto you. And we ask that you will use it for your glory. In the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Because it's not about population. Neither is it about money. Even if it is one person that we are touching, it's worth it. It's worth it. Father, we give you all the praise. Thank you for everyone that has impacted our life. Whether it's our family member, our loved ones, a pastor, a church leader, or somebody that we have met in the past. People who have become an influence on our life. People who have impacted our life. Lord, we thank you for their life. We thank you for bringing them across our way. We thank you and we give you all the glory. Lord, we pray from today as a church and as individual. We will continue to make impact in the society. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
We give you all the praise and glory. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.